Firstly, I would like to thank Shreyansh Academy for sponsoring this session. So by sponsoring this session, I mean they've been gracious enough to provide us with the Zoom premium link so that we can record the session aramse. We can have a good amount of participants. See, we are not charging you guys for the session or anything, webinar free mein hai. So what we did is we approached them and they have been gracious enough to provide us with the Zoom link. And also, I have an announcement to make on their behalf. They'll be starting with their FR demo lectures very soon. Their Instagram handle is Shreyansh_Academy_official. So you can check out the demo lectures. And I can, so I, most of us have been their students. She was ex-JKC Meenal ma'am. And it was really good experience. So I would strongly recommend you guys check out their lectures. Okay, so let's start with the session. Raj, I hand it over to you. So Raj will be hosting the session and I will be co-hosting side by side. And let's get started. Okay, Raj.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thanks, Prithvi. Quick round of introduction. Thank you everyone for joining this session. I'd also like to thank the panelists. So I'd like to give a quick introduction on behalf of our panelists. So we have Amay Dabolkar, we have Ayushi Hetvi, Sanjay, Upamanyu, and Prithvi and myself. So from the team, Vision CA team, who will be taking up the session. Apart from this, we also have some other mentors who are there to guide you all and answer your queries in the Q&A section. And they might also provide their inputs as and when required. So thanks to the team for taking this effort and helping us in this initiative to guide the young aspirants. Not taking much of your time, this is basically the agenda for the day. So we'll have three sections. First would be on CV writing, which would cover basically how to prepare your CVs or resumes and set a first impression right. And as a part of this section, we'll also cover some sample CVs, some sample tips on what you should be including and what you should not be including in your CVs. The second section would be basically on the interview cracking section. What sort of questions you can pre-prepare yourself before appearing for an interview? What sort of things you should keep in mind while appearing for an interview, and basically how you can excel it and how you can set your second impression right, and make it to their phones. And the third section would be the most frequently asked question, commonly asked questions, what firm should I select, whether it should be a big four, it should be a mid-sized, it should be a small-sized firm, how should I manage, what sort of work you get. So basically, we'll give you a brief background, what sort of work you will get, what sort of pros and cons are there across all three, and which one ideally you can suit to your best needs and take the most advantage of it. And towards the end, we'll have a participant Q&A round wherein you guys can speak up and ask questions directly to our mentors, which includes our panelists as well as our other experts, and you can get them resolved. So that's a quick intro, and I would like to hand it over to Amay, who would be taking the first session. So yeah, we'll kick started.
All right, thanks Raj. Thanks Raj for such a nice introduction. So the first session, which is kind of, I would say, the most important one as well, as because that's the first impression which you create, that is creating your CV and resume, and we'll show you some sample CVs as well. But before we begin with the preparation of your CV, I would like to show, or I would like to highlight upon, what are the results of our survey which we conducted. So we got a really good response on our survey. We got around 115 responses. And basis the response, what I could understand is most of them would like to understand how to appear to an interview as well as how to build up on your CV and resume. And in terms of the preferences, many of them prefer to attend a live webcast, and as well as some prefer to show as a pre-recorded session. So in terms of that, we try to cover both of them since we are recording the session and this will be available on YouTube. So you can access it, but you will miss the main part of it. That is interaction with us, interaction with all the mentors which we have. So that's the one of the thing. And also you will get to understand a lot of their perspective, their analysis on how and what their thought process was. So it's actually understanding more important is of the thought process rather than the way they selected it. So that's more important. And that's the one thing we should incline upon. So can you go on to the next slide, Raj? Yeah. So basically the survey conducted. So since most of them are pretty familiar with the three normal ventures like statutory audit, internal audit, and taxation, either it may direct tax, indirect tax, or the international tax. And I was surprised to see that many of them need guidance on which topic to select. And I could see that around 25%, 1/4 of them, decided upon that they will select the statutory audit as the venture to go into for the articleship. And some have decided to go with the taxation, whether it may be direct or indirect tax. So we'll keep this survey results in mind and we can just get ahead with the topics and the content through this session. And secondly, we could see that around 50% are interested in joining a Big Four accounting firm. And whereas it is equal for the mid-size as well as the small firm. And many of them have not yet decided. So these can be either shifting towards the Big Four firm or else these might be going to a mid-size or a small firm. And with regards to the last one, which is there, have you ever faced an interview? And as we were expecting, almost majority of them have not faced an interview, except barely 1/4 of the responses which have faced the interview. So the most important thing, the next slide, please. Yeah, the most important thing that basis the survey results, which you can see is you are not alone. There are many other people. So if you must be feeling like, why not have decided yet? It's a high time. Results are tomorrow. Then I have to decide it. It will be very hasty to decide. It's not like that. It's you are not alone in this journey. And you are not at all alone. If you could see all the 115 responses which you have received, they all have yet to decide on which all field they have to venture in out. So that's why we here at Vision CA have brought this initiative and created this webinar, that you can directly interact with various fields. So we have many people from audit field, many people from the tax field. Some are practicing in tax, direct tax, indirect tax. So you'll get to know their perspective as well. So let's move right into the first part of this session. That is the CV writing part. Okay, so the next slide. So the CV writing part, I have tried to divide it into the five sub parts. So the most important being CV for articleship versus what is the CV for a qualified person. What are the key elements for in a CV? And the most important part, that is how to make your CV stand out, because that's the main key element which everyone is looking for. So many of the recruiters, what they use is they use a 6-second principle. The 6-second principle is that they judge your everything by looking and glancing your CV for the just 6 seconds. And then they decide whether to continue or shortlist or whether to reject that CV. So that 6 seconds, how to make your impression in that first 6 seconds is in your hand. They have not yet seen you. They have not yet called you for an interview, but they have just your CV in your hand. So that's the most important thing, that the first 6 seconds. And that's what we are working very hard on, how to make your CV more standout and more appealing to the recruiter. And one more session which we will cover up is the CV. Is it a one-time process or is it a recurring process? We'll go deep dive into it later. And then we have a CV session Q&A, then followed by the next sessions which we have lined up. So if you, Raj, if you can go into next slide. Okay. So most important is the difference between articleship CV versus the CV for a qualified. So in articleship CV recruitment, they majorly focus on your academics, and whereas the qualified CVs more focus on what experience you have gained during the articleship. So that's the one of the key important things which you need to focus upon. let's say I've seen some of the CVs wherein you do have a lot of some professional experience, like you have interned somewhere. Let's say it might be a small internship at your known firm or somewhere like that during the process, like after post your 12th grade. But that is not a relevant experience. That is not the relevant experience which they are looking for. They are looking for the academics part of it. So that's one of the most important thing. That means you should highlight your academics first. And then if you have any work experience, then you highlight it the second part. Usually what happens for a qualified CV, usually we place the experience first and then the academics. Whereas it is the opposite for the articleship CV, wherein we face the academics first and then we get in deep dive into the any other experience or achievements which you have. And you would find a lot of CVs online, but make sure these CVs are not meant for you. These CVs are meant for the qualified or experienced hires. So never ever judge those CV with one which you have, because your CV will be judged totally upon your academics as well as the other extracurricular activities which they have it. So we'll cover up that as well, at what all the aspects they look into the CV. So that you can, it will help you to make that CV stand out, and you will get what are the recruiter's perspective basis that CV is. So I guess Raj, you can move on to the next slide. Okay, so this is the one of the important section, that is the elements which are there for the CV. So the first thing is your basic details. So you should have at least your name, the email address, the qualification, your contact number, and the most important thing, your LinkedIn ID. Now, why I have emphasized on the LinkedIn ID? Like, what happens is usually for all the recruitment, the first background check which they do is your LinkedIn account. Because usually they need to see that whether the qualification which you have posted in, whether are those updated in your LinkedIn. That is the most important thing which they look. Second thing, many of them do post the details, like if they have any if they have any connections or connections, whether they're active on LinkedIn, whether they have their presence over LinkedIn. So that will show that their profile is legitimate enough. Basis your name, email address, then the contact number, they don't get to know your legitimacy of the candidature. So that's the one of the thing which is important, that is your LinkedIn ID. So if you have not created your LinkedIn ID, make sure to create one, and that's important. And also do mention your LinkedIn ID in all your CVs so that the recruiter actually goes and check it. So I have seen personally the recruiter going and checking on LinkedIn whether they have any presence or not for articleship. So that's the most important thing which you need to cover up as your basic details. So we'll show up a format on some later slides regarding how the basic details are shown up. Then coming up with the career objective. Now, this is the main differentiating section of all of these sections, because here you will explicitly mention that you are applying for articleship. And whereas the other section will not tell you that you are applying for the articleship. Hence, you need to be very specific. Even I would rather say highlight upon the point that you are applying for the articleship in your career objectives. So in that highlighting, I mean, like you are, we'll show you some samples later on regarding how the career objectives section to be framed, wherein you will state your interest as well. We'll state your interest as well. I request participants to please stay on mute. Yeah, all right. Okay. So therein, when you'll get to understand which all section which you should apply, like let's say it may be audit, it may be tax, you will mention your interest, and basis that interest, they will shortlist you for the available positions which are there. Most important thing is it should be under 2 to 3 lines, a long paragraph. It's not a cover letter. It's just a career objective which is there. So it should be like 2 to 3 lines, and it should highlight main keywords which are there. So that's the most important part for the career objectives. Coming up to the next one, the academic qualification. So in academic qualification, include your 10th, your 12th, your bachelor program marks, or else the grade which are there, and the CA Foundation intermediate scores which are there. So coming up with this course, so 10th, 12th, you should include. You should not include anything before 10th. because that's not relevant for the applying articleship. You should also not include any semester-wise details if you have completed your bachelor's degree. And if you have not completed your bachelor's degree, it's recommended that you put semester-wise. Let's say most of them, if they are applying, doing CA with their BCom or any other courses, so they must be in second year or probably third year of bachelor programs, which they might be. So in that case, it's recommended to mention each semester-wise grades, because usually an year-wise grades are not available. Whereas if you have completed your bachelor's program, then the final grade would be sufficing. So that's more important. And then coming up is the foundation and the intermediate scores. So in foundation and intermediate scores, so in, let's say in intermediate, if you clear in one go, you just mention it in a one line. And if you clear group by group, so mention it in the separate line, like May attempt cleared this group one and November attempt you cleared this group two. And you mention in the separate line. No need to state the number of attempts which you have taken. They will usually ask you in the interview or when they have a telephonic conversation. But you can mention specifically like this is May attempt score and November attempt score, which is there. Also, do mention upon any additional exemptions or any AIR or ranks which you have mentioned in the separate column, which is there. We'll show you the sample for that. Coming up next is splitting up academic qualification, and that's what we have done in the sample CV. So what we have done is we have splitted the academic qualification into some parts like the professional qualification and educational qualification, wherein the professional qualification states more upon the CA related scores and the educational qualification states more upon your 10th, 12th and the bachelor degree program, which is there. In your technical skills, and this is where majority of you will be tested upon in the interview as well, that is your technical skills, because they require people who know certain technical applications, like let's say Microsoft Excel, Word, PowerPoint, because that's one of the major things which you will use most commonly in your articleship. They do appreciate your knowledge for the Tally ERP and that's also included as a part of your professional academic qualification, that is your IT training and the orientation course. So make sure to mention these as well in your technical skills section. And the achievements, we have covered that separately. So we'll deep dive it in the separate section, like how to stand out your CV. So that's where we have covered the achievements part, which will include how to bifurcate into academic, the extracurriculars part of it. And then coming up is your personal details. So address. So now the most important thing, many people miss their writing their addresses in the CV. Now, why that's important? So what happens is, I'll just give an example of our one of the firm in articleship, let's say PwC itself. So what happens is, for applying any application, they do require address field to be mentioned. So that's the thing which is required. And most of the portals have must require address to be mentioned. That's why it's recommended to have your address mentioned in the CV.
Just to cut you in here for a second. So even if you're not comfortable with giving your whole house address, you can just mention which city you are based out of, so the recruiter can make a relevant decision. Let's say, for example, Arko is from Jharkhand. So he can mention that he is from Jharkhand and which is a specific city. So they can make a more informed decision. So if you're from Mumbai, you can say Borivali, Mumbai, Andheri, Mumbai. Even that would be fine. But
that would be fine.
Go to this level of detail. Pura, flat number and all, if you're not comfortable, that's totally
not required.
Fine.
If you're not comfortable with that, it's fine. Yeah. Agreed, Prithvi. And then coming up languages. So in languages, you can mention all the known languages which you have, English, Hindi, and the languages which you know. And some of them do ask while in application whether they're a language, is it native, fluent, or something like that. But that specific requirement is not required to be incorporated in the CV. That's in the application portal if they require so. So that you don't need to mention, and whether it's fluent or the level of scale in which you know that language. So that's not required. It's only required in case you are applying in a portal wherein they will ask this information specifically. Now, with regards to the date of birth, some people do prefer mentioning it, and some people know it's up to you. It's kind of not mandatory to apply, and whereas some do explicitly ask for your date. So it depends upon you. So you can definitely hide your personal details, but make sure that you have at least the basics part in it, so that they can at least reach you, like the name, email, the contact number, and the LinkedIn ID. And if they require any additional information, they will definitely get in touch with you, because they want to complete your application process with all the details which they require for the application. So I guess you can, Raj, you can go to the next slide, please.
Just on a lighter note, okay. Sorry to cut in, just on a lighter note. So this is not a matchmaking biodata. You can preferably put all your date of birth and address. So it's always useful, and I think there is no harm putting it in your CV.
So Sanjay, it's a bit subjective matter.
Some might
be comfortable, some might not be comfortable. So we are just stating out what's the bare minimum.
Okay.
But right, matchmaking, right.
No problem.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So many of them do say that it's not required. So it's like the bare minimum, which is like the name, email, the contact number, so that a recruiter can at least reach you. And LinkedIn ID as well. The recruiter can at least reach you out. And why location and the city and the state? The reason being, they want to see which demographic they can fit you in. Like, let's say for a Big Four, they do have an offices across the country. So they will see that, okay, so if you are based out of that Delhi location, why are you applying to Mumbai? Better let's fill in the opportunity there in their Gurgaon office, which is there. So in that way, they are analyzing the demographics. And I think so that's where it comes. So that's upon your call, that what all details you require to mention. But certain things are bare minimum, like your name, email address. Yeah. So we can move on to the next slide. Okay, so the one of the section which I emphasized on is the career objective, and that's the only section wherein you will explicitly mention that you intend to do an articleship. You can mention that I intend to pursue my articleship, and I've mentioned it in a bold that it's required that you are mentioning about an articleship in a reputed firm which gives me a commendable exposure, use my knowledge and abilities to successfully complete the mandated articleship period, and in the process, contribute my level best to the organization. Also develop myself throughout the experience. So you can include these kind of statements, but make sure that you make these statements very unique to yourself. Because what will happen is the HR or the recruiter will receive thousands of applications having the same stated, copy-pasted career objective. But if you combine little adjectives from other wordings, and then you combine it to make your own, as well as you develop certain quality, add up some certain qualities into it, that's the way the CV will shine out. As well, it's recommended to highlight certain important section. Let's say in the next part, which is there, I'm looking for a career which will provide me an opportunity with an organization where I can contribute to learn and sharpen my skills while adding value to the organization. The ideal profile will help me to leverage my educational background in accounting, auditing, finance, taxation, and develop strong analytical skills and effective teamwork abilities. Now, it's also recommended in the ideal profile, you can also specifically mention, like, if you are interested in auditing profile, or if you are interested in, let's say, auditing profile, or if you're interested in the taxation profile. So you can specifically mention that. I guess, Raj.
I think I just had a bad connectivity. I'll just reshare my screen.
Okay. All right. The screen is visible. Yeah. Okay. So here in wherein we will specifically mention upon which domain we would like to venture it out. It's also like sometimes some firms do hire only for audit, or some firms do hire only for the taxation part of it. So it depends. So in that case, you can specifically tailor-made your career objectives, and then you can send it to the respective organization which you have. Or else you can use the second line, which is very generic one, so that if you apply to any firm, make sure to mention, if you are sending a resume, make sure you mention that which field you are interested in applying to. It doesn't look good if you mention suitable opportunities or something like that, because they are not the one who will judge you on which profile is good for you. It's you who is going to judge that which profile you want to venture in out. So it's not recommended suitable profile in your organization. If the firm is big, you can mention, I'm interested in venturing out in international taxation, or I'm venturing in auditing, or let's say in direct taxation. So you should be specific as to which profile you are interested in applying that firm, rather than being a very generic one, which is there. And this is usually applies for a mid-size to a big four firms. Whereas for a smaller firm, they do give a lot of exposure to other profiles. So that will cover up separately in the section. So like exactly how tailoring your academic requirements basis, the field you would like to venture in on. So we can cover up that in the coming part. So most important part in this career objective section is highlighting it's you intend to pursue articleship, stating your qualities into it. Let's say your strong analytical skills, or let's say you have a managerial skills, which you say. Now, most important thing is you need, while in interview, if you write you have a strong managerial skills, you need to also demonstrate them that what you have a managerial skill as. Let's say you led a club in a college, so that's one of the managerial skills which you can have. So make sure that you will have, definitely will have a questions across what career objective or what things you mention in your CV. Usually what they do is they take your CV and they start auditing what all points you have mentioned in the CV, and they make sure that whatever you have written is appropriate, and they, if they have any follow-up questions on that. So in make sure that you have a relevant example to state in. Let's say, as I mentioned about the managerial experience, you can also say that you have a strong debating skill or interpersonal skills, which you have. You might say that I have been very active on debate forums, I have participated in a lot of debating competitions, and you can state your experience and you can collate it with your career objective. So that's one of the things which you can ace in the interview, and that's your CV and your interview both are in line and it's going hand in hand. So that's most important part in the career objective, and make sure to tailor your career objective for each and every application if you want to, or else you can make a standard one and you can apply it. So that covers up the career objective part. So can, if Raj, you can go to the next slide. Yeah, so this is a sample certain section of CV, a sample design. So it's not necessary that you need to follow this same pattern, but it mostly covers most of the essential and the required fields which you have in the CV. So as I mentioned, name the qualification, you can mention CA intermediate. If you have completed your BCom, comma BCom, and as relevant. Then you mentioned your email address, your mobile number, and the LinkedIn ID which is there, and the location. Now in the location section, what you can do is you can mention, let's say Mumbai, Maharashtra, or else you can mention the city and the state name. As Prithvi also rightly said, we can mention that. So that's how you can cover up. And in career objectives, that section we described, so that you need to mention. So after your all the basic details, you mention your career objective. Also make sure that do not overextend your basic details. Like if you include your address, if you include your date of birth over here, all the over details should be included towards the end, and all the key details should be included at the start of the application. Always remember, apply the 6-second rule, that the recruiter is gonna judge you basis the 6-second rule, that they will scan your CV and then they will decide whether you are eligible to apply or you are not eligible to apply. Also, most important thing is you need to align your wordings and align your CV in a perfect presentable format. Raj, if you can go to the next slide. Yeah. So now this comes up, the qualification part. So after your career objectives, you mention about your qualification. So in qualification, as I said, SSE, HSE, the 10th or 12th, you need to mention your university and the board, like the state board, which you are there. Name of the school and college. Now, this is somewhat required more in your articleship, because they do ask questions related to which school you were in or which college you were in, because they might be of from a similar locality or background. And for 10th and 12th, you need to mention your year of passing and the percentage which you receive. So for usually for 10th and 12th, it's percentage, and for the graduation program, it's the grades which you have. So you do mention that. And since this is a sample CV wherein we're applying in the SEM 3, after clearing SEM 3 of the graduation course, I have mentioned as a sample all three semester marks. But since the annual marks are not available, let's say for SEM 1, SEM 2 constitutes as an year 1, but a consolidated grade for year 1 is not available. So it's not, even if you have got, let's say, same grades, A grade and A grade, it's not advised to combine those into one single line stating FY BCom A grade, because you don't know, because it's calculated on the basis of CGPA and it's on the basis of the final certificate which they offer, and they will do take that at the end. So if you have completed your BCom, then do mention it in the one line, or else the semester wise marks would work out.
I want to add one point. So I had seen one CV of my friend. In the education qualification, he had written some exam, scholarship exam, which he had written in his 7th standard. So I would advise that itna hi likho, jo exams apne school mein diye the, wo sab likhne ki zarurat nahi hai.
Exactly. And if you want to include also, you can include in the achievement section or extracurricular section, not in the qualification, because these are not relevant for the applications.
Yeah, because this was a seen mistake. So I would advise all the people ki utna likhne ki zarurat nahi hai. Usko aap niche likh do, agar aapko likhna hai to, lekin education qualification mein itna bare minimum hai. And wo sab likho mat, impression kharab hoga.
So what Yash is trying to say is you need to give out the key details in the beginning, and in other activities or other achievements, you can mention these things, but give it a thought that whether it is time barred. By time barred, I mean how relevant it is and how recent it is. So if it is 10 years, 15 years, 15 years, I'm saying a bit more. So if it is 6, 7, 8 years before something that had happened at the school level, 6, 7 standard, it's not relevant anymore. So that is your judgment. So as much as possible, try to keep it, put out the recent achievements more. Yes, Amar.
Yeah. So as everyone rightly said, these are the bare minimum things which you need to mention. And for any other exam, like I have do covered that section as well, like the Olympiad exam, if they have cleared. So how to include that as well, because these are some achievements which you have mentioned. And most importantly, these all things are more relevant for articleship point of view. And when you qualify and when you have an experience, these certain sections are even cut down further, and you are not required to mention these as well. So coming up with the next one, professional qualification. In professional qualification, the CPT grade or the entrance test and the inter CA grades. It is required to mention your marks obtained out of, and then if you have any exemption in the subjects, you do mention that. Let's say exemption in two subjects, and if you have an AIR, you can mention that as well. Also, what you can do is you can move this professional qualification above your educational qualification, since that's the more relevant qualification which you are applying for. So that's also recommended. But for this this sample, we have included the educational first and the professional second. So you mentioned the professional qualification first. And in case you have cleared group by group, so you can mention IPCC. Group 1, the year of passing, the marks obtained, and if any specific points. And then the group 2, the year of passing, the marks obtained, and any other specific points which you mentioned. And it's not required to mention which attempt you are passed in, because if that's one of the information which they want you, they will specifically call and or else ask in the interviews which they have. So that's not required. Coming up to the next part, which is the professional academic courses. In the professional academic courses, now why this section is very important for articleship interviews, because they do look at the people who have completed their mandatory orientation and the IT training programs which are there. And if you mention that, then they are like very much eager to go ahead with your candidature. So that's the most important thing which you should mention, and it's also important when you have completed the sim. So you do mention that. If you want to even cut this short, you can mention in a one single line, completed the orientation and the ITP training as mandated by Institute of Telecommunications of India. So that would also work out. The next slide, please, Raj.
Yeah, just one point I would like to add over here, Amay. So, like everyone, if you can see, Amay has ensured that the order of qualifications is from latest to the oldest. So you guys also need to follow this, because at the time of highlighting whatever qualifications or achievements, it should always be the latest first and then going towards the oldest one. So, well, if this point is pretty much implied in this, but you should also like make a note of it and ensure that you are also following this hierarchy in your CVs.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so let's move on to the next part. So this is the extracurricular activities. So which in is considered like the college topper. If you are any school topper, if you are any school math olympiad in the academic section. And with regards to the extracurricular, you will see that if you are any member in a college, or if you have won any inter-college competition, and if you have received any certificate of appreciation, so you will consider that. So make sure to bifurcate into two parts. One is the academic, which is your school, college, and the math olympiad usually is in your schooling days. So you can include that as well as a part of your academics. And in the extracurricular, you can mention any of the clubs which you are a member of or else a president of, and any inter-college competition which you have won. So let's move on to the next section.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the technical skills you can include upon, the most important thing you can include upon is the knowledge of the Microsoft applications. And if you have any other knowledge, let's say of Tally or the other accounting softwares, if you have, mostly it's common to have a Tally experience. And you can also include your ITT training completion and the technical skills. But since you have covered it above, it's not required that you mention that. Yeah. Coming up to the next one is the personal information, which we have covered. The next slide, please. Okay, so now this is the most important section, how to make your CV stand out. So the most important thing which you should look at is using professional fonts. That is using Arial or else the Times New Roman, and keeping the font size ideal. That is, let's say 10 to 12, which is there. And the most important thing is, I've seen many of the CVs having the different types of professional fonts, let's say any other fonts, but that's not required. Only the professional fonts should be mentioned. You should have a consistency in design and outline the CV with appropriate alignment. You can incorporate a lot of numbers in your CV, like numbers or statistics. Let's say you are if you have any number, like let's say you are a inter-college competition, you are the first winner. So you can incorporate that number across, let's say, 50 participants. So you can incorporate that numbers to make your CV stand out. Cut your big paragraphs into small bullet points. And most important thing is include phrases which are similar to your job description. That is, let's say, audit or is the taxman, which is there. And then you can highlight the keywords which are there. Make it bold, and so that it can be easily stressed upon. Raj, the next slide, please. Yeah. Now coming up to the awards and achievement section and the hobbies and extracurricular section. So in that, you should mention the relevant awards and achievements. So let's say achievements, academic achievements from 10th onwards are more relevant, because before 10th are generally not relevant. Like let's say you are a school topper in history, it's not relevant for the articleship. And it's more relevant that you state only after the 10th. It's advisable to state that. And you should include all the extracurricular achievements, even though you have achieved before 10. Let's say you were a district level player in badminton. So you can include that, so that what this section portrays is that you have a multitasking skills and abilities. So that's one of the things which you can include. In hobbies and extracurricular activities, it's not mandatory to mention hobbies. But in case you don't have any awards and achievement, it's recommended to show hobbies and extracurricular activities, as it portrays the multitasking skills. Alternatively, you can display both in your CV. So that's completely optional. You can do that. the next slide, please. Yeah, so the next section is CV building a continuous process or not? So what I recommend everyone is to continuously update your CV throughout. So how been updating means what you can do is you can maintain a register of all the details which you have. Let's say a project which you worked in and then what were the timelines which were there in the project. Let's say project started, project ended, details about the client, let's say for the largest FMCG or something like that. And what all the learning outcomes which you got, like you executed the revenue area, you did a return filing, or you had some leadership skills or a project management skill. So it's advisable that you do maintain a register for this so that it would help you for the later part when you make a fresh CV post you qualify. So that's one of the important key points which I need to highlight regarding maintaining your database for the information so that it would be easier later on to make your CV. The next slide, please. Okay, so this slide is mostly self-explanatory and it states regarding CV or a resume. So CV and resume can be interchangeably used and it does not matter for article shape. Like mostly CV is a course of life which describes the whole course and it's usually 2 to 3 pages long and it displays all your educational, professional, publications, awards, honors and achievement. Whereas the resume is short and concise document which you have. So in that case, it doesn't matter that if it is a kind of interchangeably used for article shape, it does not matter. So the next slide, please. Okay, so I guess I've covered pretty much most of the points relating to creation of CV. So if you have any questions, let me see the chat box.
Either chat box or you can unmute and
unmute yourself. Yeah,
that would be fine. So we'll take up CV related questions for 5 minutes. Then we'll move on to the next section.
Yeah.
Hi, Amay.
Yeah. Hi.
Yeah. Can we include a picture of ourselves in CV? Do we have to include a picture?
It's not required to include your picture in your CV. Not at all. But if you can, you can include your picture. That's okay. But make sure that it's a professional picture and make sure it's a professional one. That's it. So it's not required. It's not mandatory to include a picture.
Yeah, this is a very relevant question. I would say I've seen a lot of CVs where people are putting their photos. It is a recent trend, to be honest. So there's a dilemma among students. So there's no black and white, right? So either you can or you not. So if you are putting, just ensure that it's a very professional looking photo, as Amay rightly said. And even if you're not putting, it's totally fine. So some people may not like putting their own photo in a CV because the CV will be circulated at a lot of places and you might not be comfortable, which is absolutely fine. So even if you're not putting, you're not missing out on anything. So what's happening is these days, the fancy CV building websites, they have a photo section. So that's the reason the photo putting thing has picked up. And till date, I have not seen a lot of CVs with photos, but this trend has been picking up from a couple of years now. So it's absolutely fine if you're not putting your photo. You're not missing out on anything. Your CV is not missing out on anything. It's fine. Okay, next question.
Yeah,
One more thing. If you're taking decision to put, okay, it should be a white background. So professionally, make sure that it's
white.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
One more thing. You can go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Okay. Also, one more thing that make sure that your alignment is appropriate, because what happens is many of the CV also does go through the application tracking software, which they do, and they capture the relevant details and information of your CV. And that's also important that you should not make any irregular arrangements in your CV by putting your images or something like that. So it's also important that you have a good alignment. Okay, yeah.
So when you were explaining about that CV standout points, you mentioned a point which stated phrases similar to job descriptions. Can you explain in detail, like, how do we include that? And
okay, yeah. Okay, so what you can do is, mainly that section gets covered upon in your career objectives, wherein you state your interest to apply for articleship. And that's what your job description is all about. Second thing, it's been relating to which field you are interested to go with. So let's say if you're interested in going taxation, so it's better to mention that interest in making going into taxation in your career objective. So that's what is aligning your job description with the CV you put in.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yeah. Any other question? One second, we have a couple of questions.
I have a query that if there is a means the page overflows in it is means complete CV is not can be cannot be put in a single page, is it okay to go to next
okay,
page?
That's fine, or is it maximum you can do it till one page. Pages. Two
for
pages.
For articles, if two pages should be fine.
Should be fine. Try to make
one and half
one page. Yeah, one and a half is also fine. Yeah, maximum two pages. It's recommended to have a one page CV, but you can make it two pages. That's okay. Completely all right. And if you take up the recommendation of the font size, it will definitely fit up in the one page. So 10 or 12 font, which is there. Yeah. So we have a couple of questions in the chat box. Do we need to mention the date on the resume or CV? No, it's not required to mention the date or date on the resume or CV. Should we use colors in CV? Now, as we also have rightly covered upon this point, all these fancy looking website which creates your CV, they do have like a color scheme for any of the CV. It's not practically required to make your CV colorful. Usually it's more not required to do, but in case you want to, you can definitely do that. That's completely all right. But black and white CV would also do. So it's completely upon your own preference and choices. Do you need to attach a cover letter with a CV or it's not necessary? A really good question. In terms of cover letter, usually for articleship, it's not recommended or expected from a candidate. Whereas for any professional hire, sometimes they do attach a cover letter. Unless if that application specifically states that you require a cover letter to put in, you can mention that. Preferably one color only. Yeah, I guess Raj has answered that. Can you share some insights on industrial training CV? Yes, we'll do that. Not in this session. We can probably plan upon another session wherein we can also have some of other mentors which have done an industrial training and we can state their experiences and we can probably cover those part in some other webinars. So stay tuned to Vision CA's all social media handles. We'll keep you updated, Supriya. Rupal has asked,
can we put cover letter separately from CV? Two different document?
Yeah, cover letter is usually separate from CV. Cover letter is usually separate from CV, but for articleship, it's usually not expected or required. But if you want to put, you can definitely put. It's a separate letter altogether. It's not inside your CV. It's like the first page.
Yeah, sorry to cut you short. So we have only 2 more minutes for this particular section's Q&A. Now we'll move to the next session and then we'll have a final Q&A in the last round. Because so we need to cover all the topics, right? So we have 2 more minutes, guys. Shoot your questions, please.
Do we need to let me complete up with some chat questions which are there? Yeah, then we can move forward. So do we need to state some of the skills and or strength? You can state, but it's not mandatory to state that skills or strength for specifically for the articleship. But if you state that skill, make sure you have any experience or relevant factual data to share your experience on or share your insights upon. If we have completed some certification course from Udemy, yes, sure, you can include that, but make sure they are relevant for the articleship. A marketing related certification might not be relevant for, let's say, for any of the application for articleship training. If you have done any finance related, then yes, you can definitely. I have heard that we have to choose one audit or tax, so which we will cover that selection of subject, selection of the area. Do we need to attach cover letter? We have covered that. Okay, can we highlight certain words? Yes, sure, you need to highlight that, make it bold. How can a student make a good CV? What should be added as a strength as an average student passing CA Inter after several attempts? If she make sure that you ace up on a lot of in interviews as well as follow the points which were stated, that would make your application as a articleship stand out. Cover letter should be in mail. You can Can we add certification from Coursera, having completed that point? Can we put remarks column in qualification? Yeah, you need to put that. Can we ask? Okay. Only headings. Yeah, only okay, for the headings, we can do some font.
Anyone wants to ask the question directly by unmuting, then we'll take one last question, then we'll move to the next section. Please. Okay, fine. Next session, please.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so next section is on basically how to crack an interview. We have Ayushi Garg who will be leading this session. So over to you, Ayushi.
Thank you, Raj. And before I begin, I would like to say, I mean, it was a great session by you. Very patient and comprehensively, he has covered each and every thing which requires to be taken care of while drafting your CV. And now let's begin with the next session, which is now how to crack interview. Okay, again, a very important session because this is the one which can give you chills all over your body. You can feel butterflies in your stomach, right? It gives you same feeling as if you are going for an examination, sometimes even worse than that. Okay, so through this session, I'll try to make it as easy for you to go for an interview, to get more confidence. So your chances of getting into. Okay, so I have already started getting questions. So guys, please hold on your horses. Let me finish first because main bhool jaungi yaar. I mean, like, let me finish first. Let me try to answer all your questions first hand. If there is anything which you still have to ask me, you can definitely ask me once I'm done with my content. Okay, and within this session, I would like to cover as many points as possible. Okay, so and also I'll try to keep it short so that we have more time for Q&A round. Okay, does that work for you all? Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so rounds of interview. So majorly, I'm talking about articleship interviews, okay? And this also covers your after qualification interviews. So it's relevant for both of you. But majorly, you will have these four rounds, okay? Online assessment, HR round, technical round, partners round. This is a normal flow of process when you go for a big four, okay? In some other firm, they might not have a couple of rounds. But this is what majorly the process you will have to go through. Coming to online assessment. So online assessment is just to test your general ability. Okay. So many a time student they message me, okay, how do I prepare for online assessment? So it is important, but understand it is your general ability and the questions will be coming from quantitative aptitude, your logical reasoning, basic mathematics, and also from English. Okay. So if at all you have to prepare, you can maybe take any aptitude book, MBA entrance book, and read some basics from it. And even if you don't do that, it's fine. You can still clear online assessment because it is just to test your general ability. Okay, and the questions are not something for which you need to study rocket science. Next round will be HR round. HR round is going to be more about you, who you are, okay, why you want to be in the organization. They want to know more about you. Next is technical round, which will be about your competence, you know, how technically sound you are. Definitely you have cleared the examination or your results are still not out. But it will be to test your technical competence, how aware you are about the subject, how well you know the concepts. Okay, and partner round will be your overall personality, if you are suited for the organization or not. Okay, now again, I'm getting this question. English is compulsory in interview. See, it's compulsory. The mode of communication will be English only. But you don't have to be worried if your English is not very fluent, okay? Because there are a lot of students coming from small town appearing for interview. So interviewers, they do understand you might not be very fluent. So you don't have to feel bad about it. But yes, you need to be good enough to at least answer the question of interviewers, understand their questions, okay? So English is compulsory, but even if your English is not very fluent, it's fine. You still stand a chance. Next slide, please. Okay, so stages of interview. First of all, it's three stages. Prepare for the interview, at the interview, and after the interview. So we're going to look at each of the stages. What are everything you need to do while on a particular stage? So first of all, let's begin with prepare for the interview. How do you prepare yourself for the interview? Okay, so that you make a really good impression and your chances of getting into organization increases drastically. Now prepare for the interview. First of all, know about the organization. It is a must. Okay. Do some online research. Connect with people on LinkedIn. Read about the organization. Read about the latest news and know about their clients. What all services they offer. Okay. Who are their major clients? Know about the organization. Okay. Because this is a most likely question in an interview. Why us? Why this big four and not that big four? Why a mid-sized firm? Why this firm? Any interview you go for, it is very likely that you are being asked why out of thousands of firms over there, why particularly our organization that you want to join? Okay, so research well about organization. Now, second, it's a no-brainer. Prepare for the most expected question. Okay, because there will be a lot of questions, but it's good to be prepared at least for a few of them, because if you answer them well, you feel confident. Okay, and it also helps you get good impression on the interviewer. And plan for the interview day. You know, what are you going to wear? We'll cover it in detail in later slides. Okay, so let's first go to prepare for the most expected questions and let's see what are the most expected questions. So number one, tell me something about you. I hope all of us know about it. Okay, and most of you would have already, you know, prepared this question. And even if you have not, this is not something you can skip. Okay, this is like, it has really high chances of being asked. And it's not like you will be asked this question in HR round or technical round. You can be asked this questions in various rounds, even in HR, in technical, even by a partner, you can ask this, you can be asked this question. Okay, so tell me something about you. You need to prepare it really well. Okay, and now the second question comes here, what should I say? So first of all, tell about yourself, tell your name, where do you come from? Cover about your family, you know, your mother, father, very briefly. Okay, don't tell everything, but just say ki, okay, how many siblings you are. You will be asked about your sibling, what are they doing. Okay, then your educational qualification, then your achievements. Also tell about your strength and weakness. Okay, so at least for 1 to 2 minutes you should be able to talk about yourself. That gives an interview really good impression, because you are the person who you who know yourself the best. If you're not able to talk about yourself, it doesn't look good. Okay, so practice this question really well. Okay, cover everything which you want your interviewer to know about you. And I've told you what are the basic things you should include. Now, what are your strengths and weaknesses? So here you have to be a little diplomatic. Okay, we have various kinds of weaknesses, but you don't have to tell everything to the interviewer. Even if you are not punctual, don't tell interviewer that you are not punctual. You your chance of getting into organization will become zero. Okay, so you have to be a little diplomatic. Even if you are sharing weaknesses, it has to be in a way that increases, it adds to your chances. Okay, and doesn't reduce your chances. So if you ask me this question, what are your strengths? I'll say I work really well under pressure. Because most of the CA firms, they have pressures during deadlines. Okay, so this will create a good impression. I work really well under pressure. If they ask me about weakness, then maybe I'll say, I just don't do anything for the sake of doing. I need to know what I'm doing. Okay, my weakness, I don't do anything for the sake of doing. I want to know what is the reason we are doing it and why we are doing it, how we're doing. So it will tell an inquisitive part of you. Okay, you are a leader, you're not a follower, you know, you cannot just give me any work and I'll go ahead and do it. So that way it will help you. And third, I've already told you, why do you want to join us? It's a very basic question, you can expect it. Now, let's say I'm going for an interview, I'm going to PwC, they'll say, why PwC? So I'll say, PwC has the best audit practices in the market. They have really high audit documentation and auditing standards, and their audit is best out of all the big four. And also I've heard from my seniors that it has a good work-life balance, understanding people and promising career. Okay, I'm going to KPMG, it pays really well, and it has a really good clientele. And I have my seniors over there, and they have got a really good, they have really good experience over here, and I would like to join KPMG. So something like, you know, research about it. What is so good about them? Deloitte is like, it's best out of our big four. It has the best work culture. I've heard from, I've seen my seniors, they recommend me this. Something which is unique to the firm. And also if you know someone and you ask them, what is so good about it. So me, Prithvi, Amai, we are all from PwC. So that's why I could give you a lenser with a answer with a good length about PwC, not about the other before. So
guys, Ayushi was my senior. When I was article, she was my manager.
Yes. So I've been fortunate enough to have more than 6 years of experience with PwC, including my articleship. Okay, so 7 years ago, I was at your position, trying to gather knowledge so that I can get into Big Four. And I got into Big Four without any reference, coming from a smaller town and without having a very fluent English. Okay, so if you have questions like this, I think it answered all of them. And yes, I was blessed to have a great team and juniors like Prithvi. And so good to see you all again. Now, next question, where do you see yourself in next 5 years? You can be asked this question. So here, guys, one more thing before I proceed. So most of us might have plans like pursuing MBA or XYZ course or qualification after your CA. You don't need to tell this to HR of the company, okay? Even if you have such plans, don't disclose it. Don't say, I want to do MBA after CA. No. Why? Because see, from their point of view, they're looking for employees who do their articleship from here, who they train and they work with them in long term. Okay, so if you have any plans to do MBA, don't disclose it. Okay, in interview, you have to be a little diplomatic. You need to sound in interest of the company. And of course, right now, even I would suggest, even when I went to Big Four, I had a plan of pursuing MBA, which I didn't pursue. Okay, so it might change. You don't know where you are after 3 years. So it's not like hiding something from HR, but it's being wise enough. Okay.
Yeah, just to add to Ayushi on a lighter note. So if this question would have been asked 5 years back, where do you see yourself in 5 years? No one would have said, I see myself in my house for one whole year. So you are going to be wrong when it comes to where you see yourself in 5 years. So ensure that it's more aligned with the firm's vision and career wise. Yes, Ayushi.
Yes, so it's very rightly said. See, you might do MBA, you might not do. Okay, you are still not sure about it. So don't say something which you are not sure about. Well, a very wise and so smart thing to say is, I see myself at a middle level management, okay, handling audits independently, dealing with clients directly, something like that, okay, in some position of authority. If you don't know anything, I would like to see myself in a position of authority at some organization and doing good in my career, leading clients audit, whatever is your career objective, but it has to be like that. Now, most commonly asked question, why do you want to be CA? Most of us might not know the answer. Most few of us might know the answer.
You are still figuring out after becoming one.
Yeah.
Yes.
Correctly said.
This is not to discourage you guys. This is absolutely fine. This is just to say that all of us are in the same boat. Okay. So even if you don't know about it, don't worry. Okay. But be prepared. What you have to say, maybe your father or maybe someone is in your family is a chartered accountant and some person who everybody looks up to and a person, you can say chartered accountants are very sound technically and they are a very respected individual. And I would like to become one day, become like that one day. I would like to have that kind of understanding. I have interest in finance, accounts, everything. Whatever, make it, customize it as per your experience, as per your own background. Okay. But I have a decent answer for this. Now, last question, most commonly asked question. Tell me about a time when you took on a leadership role. Okay. So this is a very commonly asked question while going for a partners round. Okay. So partners, they want, even all the interviews, they want to see certain kind of qualities in you, and leadership quality is a very prominent one. Okay. Because they want leaders in their organization who can drive organization towards the growth. Okay. Even if you are just pass out from a school and, not have done much, but have a couple of instances ready so that you can answer this question. Like I was asked this question in my partner's round. Okay. They asked me, share an experience where you took on a leadership role. So I told them when I was in school, I was a head girl of my school. Okay. And that was And on sports event, sports day, the event host couldn't come to school because of a medical emergency at his place. And I took on the role and I became the event host. And the day, the event went really well. And this was something everybody appreciated me for. Maybe you went out or something happened, some incident happened when you raise your voice or you show your leadership qualities, you took charge, you did something very responsibly. Think of it, okay? Think of it. There has to be and there must be some incident in your life where you have taken charge and you have led other people, okay? No matter where it is, maybe in school, maybe any incident, you know, in your society, anything. Just think about it, spend some time, okay? But this is something which can be asked, okay? So instead of spending time in front of interviewer, do this homework, okay? This is a list of questions. Take a note of it, take a screenshot, whatever. But these are commonly asked questions. Make sure you have answers to all of them. One more thing, you will have answers, you will prepare for it, you will answer really well, but you know, you need to look authentic and honest. It's not going to be your oral test like the way it used to be in school. So ekdam rat karke ek saas mein answer nahi dena hai, okay? So pause le le karke, you know, take pauses, light pauses, and then say is as if tum thoda soch karke bol rahe ho, right? So be natural. Rat kar aaya ho ghar se aisa nahi lagna chahiye, theek hai? So have an idea what you are going to say. If not everything, jot down on a piece of paper, have an idea, okay, these are the points I'm going to cover. And then give answer accordingly. Okay, guys. Next slide. So interview, prepare for the interview day. Very important attire. Okay, this is what will help you get good first impression front of your interviewer. So needless to say, your attire needs to be formal. Okay, all of us know that. But at the same time, it needs to be comfortable, something you're comfortable within. Because if you're sitting in something which is really tight or you're not comfortable, you're not sure about, you won't be able to focus on the interview. You won't feel confident. Okay, that will hamper your level of confidence. So your attire needs to be formal and comfortable. Take care of both these criteria. Now coming to formal, of course, in when it comes to boys, it has to be a formal pant, trouser and a shirt. Okay, combination light dark hona chahiye. It's not like top to bottom black man. We all love black, but make sure when you go for interview, it has to be a combination of a light short pant. It looks good and a tie is must. Okay, wear a tie. Blazer, I would say you might wear a blazer, you might not wear a blazer, but tie has to be there. Okay, top collar button should be closed and tie ka jo length hona chahiye, it should, the tip should touch to the top of your belt. Okay, it should not be very long tie. So that is what the length of tie should be. Coming to girls, you can wear skirts, one pieces, formal dresses only if you're comfortable. Okay, don't wear it to make yourself stand out. You don't have to be a head turner when you go over there. You just need to look decent. Even if you're wearing shirt and trouser, it's good. It's recommended wear shorts and trouser, which looks good, which makes you look professional. Okay, now the place of interview. So the place of am I audible?
Yes,
Aishu.
I don't know, I can't see you all. Okay, got it. Sorry, my mistake. So place of interview, research about the place of interview. Where is it? Okay, if you're going, you're traveling to some other town, make sure that you reach that place on time so that you have sufficient time to get ready and travel to the place of interview. Okay, and because you have to reach at least 15-20 minutes before. Okay, see how far it is from your place. What is the traffic condition during your interview time? Okay, so do that little homework. Now things to carry for the interview, 2-3 copies of your resume, couple of blank papers if you have been asked a question which you have to solve, couple of blank papers and a pen. These three things are must. Okay, you can choose to carry original mark sheets and your certificates if you have any. Even if not so, you can carry photocopies if you're not comfortable. Okay, it's good if you keep it in a folder. Okay, keep 2-3 copies of CV very handy so that you don't have to search it and the copies of CV needs to be handy so that you can hand it over to the interviewer or at the reception whenever it is required. Also carry the photocopies of mark sheet because many times they ask for it. Now, again, very importantly, know everything written in your CV. Again, here I would like to give you a tip. Your CV should be 80% of who you are, okay? Not 102% or 120% or 200% of who you are. Make it 80%, okay? Because if you have a really good CV with a lot of achievement, this and that, and if your personality is not able to justify your CV, then it creates a bad impression. Because after reading your CV, the interviewer have expectations from you according to your CV, okay? So make it like 80% of your personality so that you stand out to be a better person than your what your CV says. And the purpose of CV is not to get the job. Okay, get this very thing clear. The purpose of CV is not to get the job. The purpose of the CV is to get the interview. Okay, it truly really help you get the interview. And at interview, you have to perform so that you get the job. I hope you understand. So it has to see it this way. Okay, once you have appeared there, your CV takes a second position and it's you in the front. So know everything which is written in your CV. Okay, be authentic. Even if you don't have so many things on CV, don't be, I would say, disheartened. See, to get into any good firm in Big Four, you need to be either of the two. Okay, either you have a really good academic background, you're a ranker, topper, things like that, okay, that can help you get into Big Four if you are technically very sound, if you have really good academics. Or it can be you are a good student, a bright student, but with a good personality, with a good extracurricular. Okay, either be a balance of this or, you know, really good at academics. Either of the situation, you stand a chance to get into Big Fours. So no, read everything which you have written. If you have written any qualities like I'm this, I'm that, you need to have an answer. How have you justified that you have this quality? And if you're not sure, don't mention big words like, you know, I'm when you're going for articleship, at least when you have lesser of instances to quote, I'm a leader. You know, we write all those adjectives. If you're not sure, if you don't have an incident to back it up, then you can skip it. Next slide, please. Yes, so when you go for a technical round, make sure that you have brushed up your technical skills because it has been a while that you have given your examination. Okay, so make sure you go through all these topics before you go for a technical round. You read Ind AS, important ones I've mentioned, revenue, leases, PP, borrowing, financial assets and liabilities, foreign exchange, impairment, assertions. Very likely to be asked, like, you know, you need to know assertions at transaction level, at balance sheet level, what are they, and have theoretical knowledge about it. Okay, because in Big Four audit revolves around assertions a lot. Even in mid-size firm, I'm telling about Big Four because I've audited only in Big Four. So assertions you need to know, whatever interview you are going for. And standards on auditing 300 series is again very important. Audit documentation, SA240, fraud, auditor's responsibility, when there's a fraud and then going concern. Then read CARO. Again, this is a hot topic, impact of COVID-19 on financial statement. So go through it, read about it, what is there. Companies Act, important provisions, and then about income tax, what are the heads of income tax, those five heads, and other basic topics, resident, non-resident, you might be asked. Okay, so you are not going for examination, you don't have to run through everything, but just have a glance through everything, you know, your entire portion, so that any subject you are being asked, you are in a situation, you know, to answer. Next slide, please.
Ayushi, just one point to add over here. So like in place, so I understand inter CA students do not have Ind AS in their curriculum. So okay. So they can replace that with the AS part. So accounting standards, you can be well aware of technically sound, okay, what's there into multiple ASs. And Ind AS, basically what you can do is students, you can get a brief idea of, okay, what are Ind AS actually, what is the roadmap, and some sort of basic understanding. They won't go into much into technical depth, but accounting standards, you can expect questions very much around there. And in case, you know, like there is a question and you are not able to think of it or you're not having a answer. So you can ask the interviewer, okay, sir, can I take a minute to think of it? Take a minute, take a deep breath, think of it and then answer. This is not a fastest finger first session. You and the interviewer are the only person who would be sitting in that session. Think of your answer and say it rather than just blindly answering first and then thinking, okay, what I said, whether that was correct or not.
Right. So great.
Also, one more point to add upon that, in case they do ask you for any index question, it's good to state that index was not in your curriculum, but if you have any idea on that, then you can say, I would like to make an educated guess on this particular index. It's good to give a try at least, because sometimes what will happen is they will see that you are eager to learn, or the skill for eagerness to learn something will come into you. So that's one of the points which I would like to state. Thank you.
Great point, guys. Thank you so much. Next slide, please. Okay, on the day of interview. So here comes a D-Day, okay, for what we are discussing and having these sessions after all. So as I said, reach 10-15 minutes earlier. Okay, it gives good impression. Be before the time. Okay, and next is show some etiquettes. Well, what I mean by etiquettes is, these are like non-verbal clues, like how you're conducting, how you're behaving, which will give a lot of insights to a company and to the interviewer. So etiquettes basically like when you are being said, okay, go for an interview, don't just go. Okay, knock, give a knock at the door and ask very politely, you know, may I come in? And then only you enter. And even after you have entered, just don't take a seat. Like a shameless person. Okay, wait for the interview to tell you, okay, please stay, have a seat, and then you take a seat. And you can keep your folder on the table and, you can wait there patiently. You can sit there patiently. Now, next come your body language. So body language, have a confident body language, okay? Don't rub your nose, stroke your hair, you know? Don't have this not so confident body gestures. When you're sitting over there, make sure your posture, maintain your posture. Sit with a straight back, okay? Don't slouch, doesn't look good. So sit with your back straight, okay? And have a slight smile on your face. Okay, even if you're not feeling like smiling, I'm just kidding. But try to have a slight smile on your face, because it, gives a positive impression. Because when we see a person smiling, we are tend to smile back. So that's human psychology, you will definitely smile back. So have a slight smile on your face, but make sure you are not flaunting your teeth for no reason. Okay, have a slight smile on your face. Now, the next is impress with also body language. Use hand gestures, okay? If you, like I'm explaining to you, and I think, okay, my hand gestures can help me, use it only if it's needed, okay? Use it 2-3 times, like, but it's not necessary to keep your hands, like, open in this, in the air all the time, okay? But if it's required, don't hesitate. Use your hand gestures. Now, one more question which is commonly asked is about handshake. Should I do the handshake? There is no compulsion. Okay, if the interviewer is looking at you, smiling at you, and appearing to be friendly, you can go ahead and initiate a nice handshake. But maybe it happens that your interviewer is busy, maybe having a look on your CV, and he just told you to take a seat, then it's okay. Even if you miss this opportunity, it's fine. If you're comfortable, do the handshake. If there's an opportunity, do the handshake. No compulsion. If it's not, then go and have a seat. So in my interviews, I didn't do handshake because the interviewer was looking at the CV or involved in some other work. So there is no rule like handshake is a must. If you can initiate, you can do, go for it. If not, it's fine, completely fine. Then next is impress with your communication. Now what I mean by impress with your communication is be to the point, okay? Don't keep on talking for like 2-3 minutes to know what interviewer has asked for. If they ask a specific question from a essay, answer only that. Don't narrate him the entire essay, flaunt your knowledge about, you know, how well you know everything. No, keep your answers to the point, short, crisp. Okay, and if you don't know something, most of the time, students, they worry, what if I don't know the answer? So it's completely fine. So like Rajan Ahmed said, if you don't know, you can say that, okay, it was not a part of my syllabus. And if it was a part of your syllabus and you don't know, sorry, I don't know, I'm not aware about it. if you know a little bit of it but you're not sure about it, then say, okay, well, I'm not sure, but this is what I think. And it's absolutely fine. Okay, in any examination this world, it's not 100 out of 100 which is passing percentage or criteria. So if you are able to manage 70-80% of giving right answers, you stand a chance, you stand a good chance. But make sure that you are keeping your answers to the point. Okay, you need to be loud enough for the other person to hear you well. Okay, just don't keep on talking. Tell what you know, and if you don't know, then admit it, and it's completely fine. And as Prithvi said, ki honesty is the best policy. Yes, be authentic, be honest, don't try to be someone who you are not. Okay, but it's good that even if you're not confident, you try to feel confident. It's completely fine. But I'm talking only in terms of something you do, you don't know technically, because a person sitting in front of you is much more experienced. So, keep that in your mind. Now, next slide. Okay, so here we are at the end. And I can see already we have a lot of questions in the chat box.
So this is the end of the second section on interview. So before we go to the next section, we'll have 5 minutes Q&A for this particular session. So you can start asking your questions over chat box or by unmuting yourself.
Ayushi, hi. So while your session, we got some certain questions. So I've just jotted down certain points which were there. So if you can help us in understanding this. So Supriya asked, what are the things that needs to be kept in mind while preparing for the virtual interview in this current COVID scenarios?
Okay, yes, that's a good question. And it might possibly you're going for a virtual interview. So it's quite basic. If I say, ki, like, we are organizing this webinar, what do I look at? Okay, if my network is fine, okay, if the background is fine, how am I looking in the, at the screen? I'll just check my setup. And apart from being set up, like everything which we have discussed applies here also. You know, I need to have that slight smile. I need to greet the interviewer. Hi, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. Good morning. Whatever it is. So there won't be much difference, because now this entire world under COVID situation has gone virtual. Okay. So it's like having the person sitting right in front of you. So again, everything applies here. You need to maintain your body language, your gesture, your facial expressions. Just with an addition that you take care of your setup, you know, where you are going to sit, how's your network and how you're looking. That's it. Like it's not something, in fact, I think it will be an advantage, because you will be more, you will be less nervous because you are in a familiar surrounding. So that's good.
One more quick thing just to add. So what happens is, if you're sitting for an interview or something, your family members would be very curious or excited than you, so they might peep in or try to come. So it's very natural. It happens even at my place. So what I prefer to do is I sit facing the back, or you can sit with the room locked or room shut, the door shut, if that's possible. Else, these are small tweaks that you can do, nothing major. So these are small things to keep in mind.
Yes, it's correct. Make sure that there is no background noise, okay? Because it can create difficulty if the interviewer is not able to hear you well.
Also, make sure that you are in the right position from your camera, not too front or not too back from the camera.
So guys, join the link 10 minutes prior to your interview if you are to appear for a video conference interview. And make sure your camera is working, you are comfortable sitting on the chair. Okay, try to speak a few words before if anyone is joining in, and just make yourself comfortable and politely go ahead with the interview. It's very much same as the in-person interview.
Right.
So we have received, I think, 2 questions in the chat box. So anyone who wants to unmute
them, worries about not being fluent in English. So guys, I'd like to add few tips for you. So first of all, if you feel you're not very fluent, see, doesn't matter how many webinars you are attending, what all you are learning, you will never be fluent at English this way. See, I can watch thousands of videos on how to swim, But until and unless I jump into a pool, get myself drawn from top to bottom, I won't learn swimming, right? So instead of researching about ki kaise seekhe, kya hoga, it's fine if you are not fluent. Just keep in mind you need to start, and earlier the better. Practice, okay? Talk to your friends in English. Talk to your relatives who can speak well. Talk to them in English. Okay, you can learn this skill only by practicing. There's no other way around.
Ayushi, to add a point. Hello.
One more thing, which can help you is start thinking. Okay, if you don't have anyone to talk to, start thinking in English. That is when you are talking to yourself, and nobody is going to judge you. But if you are able to talk to yourself in English really well, then it will boost your confidence. Okay. And ultimately, like if I've spent 4 or 5 days thinking in English, make yourself think in English. If I've spent 3 or 4 days thinking in English, naturally, on the 7th, 6th, 7th day, when you talk in English, you will be little more fluent and better. Right? Because even when you're talking to yourself, you have practiced. So that is what I would like to add when it comes to being fluent in English.
Ayushi, just one more point to add.
Yes.
Yeah. So the most important part of which I believe, it's tell me about yourself. Okay. So you just start preparing about yourself, like as you said, 5 days or 6 days before an interview. Keep practicing that, because what an HR or maybe a interviewer, he checks your communication skills on tell me about yourself, because you have to say tell me about yourself within 1.5 minutes, you have to tell about yourself. So it looks very easy question, but they take a lot of meaning out of it. So make sure that your tell me about yourself is fluent. So it's an impression creating answer what you will do there.
Correct. So that is why it was the first question. And again, it can help you create a really good impression in front of interviewer. Also, try practicing or other questions also in front of mirror. Okay, that will really help if you're practicing giving answers in front
exactly,
of mirror.
Exactly, it helps a lot.
Yes, very right.
I wanted to ask a question.
Yes.
Yeah. Does a college name impact the possibility of getting into a Big Four? Like, do they prefer someone from St. Xavier's more than other colleges?
Okay. See, it might help you create a good impression, but ultimately your college doesn't have much to do with your articleship. In fact, at times it can be a disadvantage if you have strict rules in your college, like attendance, so and so. But nevertheless, to answer your question, no.
So by chance, if you're having such strict rules of attendance, how should we like put forward it so that that doesn't make a weakness for us?
See, so as I've told you, college name doesn't really help add or something. So even when I was pursuing articleship, there were many articles from NM College and they have this strict attendance rules and all. But in Big Four, they're understanding. Okay, so they want variety, they want to diversify their articles pool. So definitely there will be certain students from a college where have stringent or strict rules, and where some students who are pursuing their BCom or their bachelor's even from correspondence. So it doesn't really add something, or even it doesn't really less your, decreases your chance of being selected. To conclude, you just don't need to be bothered about your college name.
Okay,
yeah,
thank you so much.
Yeah, Yashvi, I hope your query is cleared. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. Any other questions? So we'll move to the final session then.
Ma'am, if the first initial impression in an interview goes bad, then how to gain confidence in that case?
Okay. And why are you thinking like that to make it bad? See, it might... You're worried about it, that you'll mess it up in first few minutes and then you won't be able to feel confident. Is it so?
It has happened in my past life, so I'm a bit tensed about it.
It's okay. So even if something like this has not happened, it's very normal to feel nervous and not so confident. Okay. But how to feel confident is by thinking of more confident thoughts. Okay. let's say ki main I fall down before entering to the cabin and I'm like ki shit ye maine kya kar diya, she is so stupid, how could you do that, definitely I'll lose all my confidence. Theek hai, now another scenario, I fall down okay on the floor, I'm like kya shit, I'm like this was not the good timing, but again it's funny, like itna bura kaise ho sakta hai, like it's okay, I'm a human being and I'm allowed to fall down, it's fine. So you need to change your thinking, you know, what is going in the background is what is going to be in front, on your face, on your personality. So you need to forgive yourself for whatever mistake you committed or you end up committing, okay, and don't feel bad about it. So you need to change the way you are looking at ki agar aise socho maine kharab kar diya, maine bad impression create kar diya, so that won't help me. Now it's like ki isko sudharna kaise hai. So change your thought process in that situation, think positive.
Hello ma'am.
Yes.
I had this particular question that if in an interview we are told like we actually want to work for a specific domain but we have to settle with audit. So is it good to state it to the recruiters that you are looking out for an interdepartmental transfer maybe in the second or the third year?
Okay, so such kind of cases, like even if you tell them there is a very, very less likelihood of you getting transferred. Okay, so maybe if you are not fine with audit, you don't go for an interview, you go for interview and you try to get into that particular domain only. But to tell you, you don't get certain domains while pursuing articleship. Okay, you don't get into advisory, getting into taxation is really difficult. So ultimately, most of the time, audit is what you have to settle down with. And if at all you happen to perform really well, you get to be in the good books or something, so you might also get transfer. But telling this to interviewer won't help you. And if you are not fine with audit, then it's better that you go for some other opportunity. Don't go for it at the first place if you don't want to pursue it. But don't go with an intent ki okay, you take me in audit and then I'll take inter-department transfer. That will not be entertained. That might be entertained only once you prove yourself, which will happen after you join them. And it's like very rare. Like, trust me, I've been there for 6 years. I have not seen such case where somebody has got interdependent transfer. So don't go with that hopes, I would say.
This is very firm specific and very subjective.
Yes, yes. I'm answering only from a Big Four point of view. Again, in mid-size firm, you get exposure to various domains. So that is completely fine. But I'm telling you for Big Four.
So ma'am, that won't create a negative impact, right? On the interviewer,
like, I'm not focused on one domain. Again, it depends on which firm or which kind of firm you're going for. Like I said, ki it's for Big Four, like it's very less chances of getting of transfer. But if you're going for a mid-size firm, it's fine if they have such domain. So you need to do this check at first place. Do they have such domain in their firm? And it would be better if you can connect with people in that domain through LinkedIn. Okay, connect people and see if there is any some working in that domain at articleship level. So here you need to do homework, you know, and it will come under researching about the org. If they have such domain, if they have articles in that domain, you know about the procedure to take inter-department transfer and have a discussion with them. Okay, is it possible? And if it goes well, then maybe you can say. But if it's not so, then you should not say ideally, or you should not even go in that case if that is not fine with you. Check about the firm's policy, connect with people in that domain, I would say.
How should we answer this question? Why should we choose you over the others?
Okay, so maybe so one thing, you read the job description before going for an interview. Okay, what kind of skills they are looking for in a candidate. Okay, you can say ki, okay, I've gone through the job description and I feel I have all the qualities that you are looking for and I can meet your expectation, and if given a chance I can be a great asset and, you know, add value to your firm, like this. Or maybe if you remember the job description, tell them ki, you know, these are the qualities and I think I'm my qualities align very well with your expectation. I believe I'm a perfect fit for this job. just convince them. So here you have to see how well you can justify their, you know, your qualities can justify the job description, what they are looking for.
Yeah, I think, sorry to interrupt. Yeah, I think we had a great session. So let's thinking if we can have the session 3 and towards the end, we can have a Q&A again. So whoever is left out, maybe they can pop up their questions after that section. So thanks Ayushi for a wonderful session. You are a great orator and we had some good takeaways today. And thanks to Amay as well for the CV writing session. We'll quickly jump off to the section 3, which is which firm to choose, the pros and cons between the big four, mid-size and the small size firm. So over to you, Hitvi and Sanjay.
Thank you, Raj. Thanks, Ayushi, for the amazing session. You've answered all the questions for interview. And guys, now I'm going to start with Big Four, and then Sanjay will take over for pros and cons of mid-sized firms. So most of y'all, when we are studying, like when I was studying IPCC, and as soon as I passed my exams, the first thing that we do is we go on Google, we search for, you know, top CA firms in Mumbai or top CA firms in Delhi or wherever y'all are based out. So we come to know about Big Fours, and it is very fascinating. Like, you hear from people, you know, people who are, you know, doing articleship from Big Four, and you see that they have high stipends. This is the most fascinating thing for us as students, that because we're going to start earning. And so basically I'm going to, you know, figure out, or I'm going to try and demonstrate what are the pros and cons of joining as an article in a Big Four. First things first, so everyone knows that Big Four is a brand. Getting that name on your CV is going to, you know, help you a lot for getting your first job post-qualification. Some of you might know that once you all, you know, clear CA finals, ICI does campus placements. Many of the firms there, or many of the MNCs that come for campus placements, they have criteria where they prefer candidates who have done their articleship from a Big Four firm. So there, if you have done your articleship from a Big Four, whether it be PwC, Deloitte, EY, KPMG, any of the Big Four, you may have an added advantage over there, because some MNCs prefer a Big Four articleship client over some other article who has done articleship from a mid-size or small-size firm. So that is a very, you know, huge advantage from doing your articleship from a Big Four. Apart from that, at a very young age, like even only when you're 19 or 20, you get exposure to clients which are, you know, big corporate clients, listed companies, and mostly you know, Big Four firms offer articleship in the field of audit, statutory audit and internal audit. And doing audit of such big firms and big companies, you get a exposure to higher ranking client. You get your communication skills improve a lot, and you get a chance to have a corporate exposure at an early stage in your life, which also helps you to, you know, ability to inculcate, inculcates the ability to take higher responsibilities. Apart from that, once you have completed your articleship from Big Four, of course, depending on your CA final results, if you clear, most of the Big Fours will offer you a job at the Big Four itself. And most of the times the package that they offer is more than what they would have offered to an outsider. It of course then depends from team to team, but yeah, you have an in-hand job offer post qualification, for which maybe, you know, others who have done their articleship from mid-size may find it a bit difficult to get their job in Big Four post qualification, or even to schedule an interview. Raj, can we move on to the next slide? Thanks. So apart from, you know, all the benefits, the CV that, you know, your CV is going to get stronger from the Big Four brand name, etc. And you're going to get an upper hand post qualification. There are some cons which, you know, you should keep in mind before you take up a job opportunity in or an articleship experience in Big Four.
One is it may be difficult to balance your CA final studies, which includes your classes, coaching classes, as well as your self-study for CA final when you are doing your articleship in Big Four. This may be difficult because, as I told, the domain that Big Fours offer for articleship these days is majorly restricted to audit. They don't give you articleship opportunities in taxation. Like, it's very rare if you have partner level or direct level references. Apart from that, in transaction advisory or in any other, due diligence teams, etc., they hardly give you articleship opportunities. So normally you would get articleship for in Big Four for internal audit or stat audit. And knowing that you've selected a Big Four for articleship in audit, you might have to travel for clients which are outstation. I'm sure most of you must have heard outstation audits, etc. So while you are traveling for your audits, there may be prolonged period of outstation audits, and you might miss your coaching classes. So you should be sure enough that in spite of missing your coaching classes, you will, cope up with your studies and you'll be able to balance it. If you are confident on that part, then, you need not worry about this. But otherwise, managing the studies as well as articleship in Big Four might get difficult. And of course, this also depends on your team. So always before you take articleship in Big Four, it is very important that you know someone or you connect on LinkedIn, etc., to someone who is a part of that team, so that you can ask them what are the working hours, etc., and get an insight of how the team exactly works. So that might, help you to understand a bit whether the team has long working hours, etc. Normally in mid-sized firms, you have long working hours, but that is restricted to a particular season. For example, if you're working in tax or audit, there are tax audit seasons where you have pressure in July, September, etc. But apart from that, you don't have pressure all through the year. Whereas in Big Fours, depending, mostly because of the clientele that Big Four has, there is normally 365 days pressure, which can be there. Then, of course, it depends on your team, how much it is dependent on the article itself. But otherwise, it may be, it may be suggestive that you discuss with someone who is already working at that team and get an insight of the working hours, etc. The most important drawback or the most important factor that people who take articleship in mid-size consider is the specialization in Big Four. So what is there is no particular rotation policy in Big Four. So if you have opted for articleship in a particular department, you'll have to stick there for 3 years. In fact, even in audit or even in tax, if you get articleship experience, there are departments in audit itself, like there is financial services. So if you are in financial services audit, your clients would typically be NBFCs, banks, etc. So all 3 years, you would be stuck with clients which are from these sectors only, and you'll have to perform audit for clients which are NBFCs or banks, etc. So there is a lot of specialization and sector or departmentalization in Big Fours. There is no per se a rotation policy. So if you maybe join Big Four and 1 year down the line you realize that you're not enjoying it, then it may be a bit difficult because Big Fours normally do not give internal transfer or even external transfers to some other firm. So that may be a bit difficult. Then the CA final leaves. So, I don't know how many of y'all had joined, but when the session just began, Prithvi was saying that right now, till you clear CA finals, your main focus should be clearing CA finals. So, before you all join, it is very important to know from the HR or from the team that how much leave you will be granted for CA finals. Because knowing that you might miss some of your coaching because of long working hours or because of outstation audits, you will require a few more days of or a month extra from what others might require to get on track with your studies. So it is better that you clear how much CA final study leaves you will get, and only if you're okay with that much amount of leaves, you should go ahead with, you know, taking this opportunity. All said and done, you know, there are pros and cons for mid-size as well, like just like for big fours. But the CV or the impact that a big four articleship has on your CV is always going to give you an upper hand for your post-qualification job. And it more or less it depends on after after qualifying as a chartered accountant, what exactly do you want to do? Because if you want to start your own practice, it would be better if you get an understanding of how all the field works, how all the fields work, that is taxation, audit, etc., which a big four might not be able to provide you. You'll get all the understanding in mid-size or even in small size for that matter. But if even after clearing CA, you're looking for, you know, job only, even after qualifying for CA, then Big Four might be the best option for you, considering the other factors, your CA final leaves, etc. So I'll stop here for any questions, or we could take that after Sanjay completes his mid-size this thing.
Yeah, thanks, Hitvi. So we'll take up Sanjay's session and then we'll have a final Q&A.
Sure.
Yes. Thanks, Hitvi, for nicely explaining. You have done my job very simple. To simply put it, your pros of Big Four is cons of a mid-sized firm, and your cons of Big Four is a pros of a mid-sized firm. But that on a lighter note. So how I would be telling you about the pros and cons of a mid-sized firm. So before that, I would like to tell my this particular the session. I want to divide into two parts. So first part is I would like to focus on the mindset. So what do I mean by mindset? So the thing which I'm trying to put forward is, whether it's a big four or whether it's a mid-sized firm or whether it's a small size firm. So the first thing begins with ourselves. So wherever you work or whichever place or whomever with you work, okay, it boils down to ourselves. So we should have a right approach and a right mindset to begin with, and a disciplined mindset. So suppose if at all I work for a big four as an articleship, but then I don't have a right approach, so I may not learn. And the same person who is doing from a mid-sized firm, who has a right attitude and a good mindset, like a discipline or qualities including dedication, discipline, mindset, curiosity, he'll be in a better position after 3 years. So having said that, okay, we need to make better choices also. Okay, so Big Four has its own pros and cons. Mid-sized firm also has got its own pros and cons. So we need to make smart choices. Each choices mostly depends on individual. Okay, there are some industry norms. Okay, if you do from a Big Four, you will get a quality job. Okay, it's agreed, taken, it's proven. But it is not like if you have done from a mid-sized firm, you will not land up in a very good job. So that myth needs to be broken. But having going inside and going by a probability or going by a more realistic view, okay. So yeah, if 100 people are doing from Big Four and 60, 70 will land up in a very good job. Okay, so yes, so coming to the pros of a mid-sized firm, and I would also like to tell you one thing is, if the TN Manoharan, who hails from Chennai, he has got a Padma Shri award, okay, but he has done from a very small size firm, so it is not, it also boils down to how much you learn, how much you grab from others is also a very important point when you start with your articleship career. Now, coming down to your pros and cons of a mid-sized firm. Okay, so the very first point is exposure in various fields. As Hetvi has already said, that if you want to start a practice, let's say after a post-qualification, okay, or you would like to take a work experience where you have experience in various fields. So in comparison to your Big Four, a mid-sized firm will give you a better experience in terms of your objective of learning in various domains of a CA work. So the mid-sized firm to give you more insights. If you join a mid-sized firm or small size firm, so let's say after 3 years you would have done a tedious return filing or a compliance work of all income taxes, GST, ROC, and you would have also done some tax audits, and you would have also done some quality internal audits. So it will give you a mixture of all the work. Whereas a Big Four, as Hetvi has already informed you that, okay, you will be in a particular department, and in that department you will be specific to a sector. So in comparison to that, a Big Four will give you a very good opportunity to learn in that particular aspect. And also the second point carries from first point, that helpful in providing an understanding what is your field of interest. So most likely when I was joining an articleship firm, so I was having this notion that no, I want to do tax, I want to do tax, I want to do tax, because I liked that as a subject. But when I start doing it something, and when sometimes what happens when you do, you know about things more. So in that term, the mid-sized firm may help you because you have done various kinds of work. It's not that you are doing a very in-depth or you are just signing off something, but you get a fair idea about how things work. So that might help you, and actually that helps you in deciding your field of interest. The third point is softer workload except season time. Yes. So a mid-sized firm or a small-sized firm in comparison to a Big Four will have a very employee-friendly work hours except for tax audit season. And you will not be burdened with lots and lots of work in comparison to a Big Four. Yes, you will have, it's not like you won't have work, you will have times where you need to sit late and work longer hours. But yes, the mid-sized firm and small-sized firm gives you that flexibility and better balances between studies and articleship, of course. So if you go to a Big Four, you will have a more kind of a corporate culture, a process-oriented organization, where the process works for everyone in the same manner. A mid-sized firm, you will have more flexibility, you will have a personal debt with the partners, and they understand. I'm not saying that the Big Four doesn't understand much, but then you have a personal connect, and if you see the work-life balance also, so it gives you an opportunity to do your studies and go to classes smoothly than that of a Big Four. Raj, if you can move to your cons. Okay, so lesser exposure to corporate clients. So this is not a hard and fast rule. Some mid-sized firm have got really good clients. Okay, and it is not equally balanced, but it's not completely written off also. But then it depends upon which kind of a mid-sized firm you join. Yes, but to be outrightly saying, you will not have that kind of a Forbes 500 or a very big MNC kind of an experience, which hardly few mid-sized firm has. So lesser exposure to corporate clients and a corporate culture, you may miss out on that particular part. may have to do everything, including admin work. Very true. So this point is very subjective. Okay, but and also because when I joined, so in my home they said, okay, so you have to do everything because you learn even smaller things you learn. So people mostly get agitated by not doing a vouching, which you do anyway in Big Four also. But that's a starting point of learning. You should never miss the step one to climb step 10. So in that way, but you will have some kind of a non-valuated works in some small size firm or mid-size firm. That happens. It's reality. So that kind of so if you stuck with a principal where he's giving a personal work, that doesn't happen. But sometimes it's realistically we have heard also. So those admin works, so that can be a challenge. Then the third point is significantly lower opportunities for learning new software. Okay, so this point, if you join a Big Four, what happens is because Big Four has got the infrastructure and resources to use all these new softwares and bots where they use in audit. It's more kind of an audit specific point where the Big Four has got the resources that they apply bots in doing a vouching or maybe use a data analytics software for analyzing the transaction happened during the year, which a mid-sized firm will most probably won't deploy. So you may miss out on that particular aspect. Lesser stipend. Your approach in your articleship shouldn't be your monetary terms, but having some students will have a challenge on your financial constraint. In that case, the Big Four may help you better than a mid-sized firm because the Big Four pays a very good compensation to interns. With that comes your own pros and cons. And coming to the fifth point, post-qualification switch. Yes. So if you are qualifying from a Big Four and you are not, you doesn't hold a rank, it's not like a thumb rule that a Big Four candidate will be chosen over a mid-sized firm, but this is a statistics where it's a notion. It's kind of real, a little realistic also, that you may land up in a better job and you will have open opportunities because you have done a very higher corporate clients and your Big Four CV speaks for itself. So in that terms, definitely it helps you a lot. But in a mid-sized firm, you may not have that advantage of switching over, getting a big clients. But this comes with a provision that if you do a mid-sized firm, get a rank or maybe get a good score, or if you perform very good at the interview, so you will land up at a very good job. It's not like I'm telling a complete negative, but yes. So these are some small advantage, disadvantage you have between a mid-sized firm and small-sized firm. Yes. So I conclude this. If you have any questions, you can put to Hetvi and me.
Yes. So Raj, we are done with all the slides, right? Yeah. Raj, you can run through this slide.
Thanks to Sanjay and Hetvi for this amazing session of yours. So to guys, before we jump off to the Q&A section, just wanted to brief you around what Vision CA actually is. So we understand a couple of you might be attending our webinar for the first time. So would not take much time of yours. Basically, we are just Vision CA is a social initiative which has been started by a team of qualified chartered accountants so that we can bridge the gap between the qualified CAs as well and the aspirants. So what we do is basically we tend to, based on your queries, we tend to arrange such initiatives like we had one today. And we also have our social media handles wherein we have formed groups, and we tend to, our mentors tend to solve your queries, your doubts, or whatever may be your concerns around the Chartered Accountancy course. So that's how it is, and you can follow our handles, social media handles, to stay tuned with such upcoming initiatives. And definitely, it would be relevant from the point of Chartered Accountancy, as well as whatever basic thoughts or questions you have, you can feel free to post on that, on such groups. Yeah, so I think we can have a final Q&A section over here. So if anyone of you would like to speak up and ask question to our mentors or panelists, maybe please unmute yourself and you can.
I guess a couple of people have raised their hand, so we can probably state their names. I guess Pooja Sharma has raised their hand. Pooja Sharma, if you can unmute
hello.
Yourself.
I have a doubt regarding outstation audits. If I state in the interview that I do not prefer outstation audits, will they reject me as a candidate?
Your chances of getting selected will definitely get reduced if you are not rejected. They prefer candidates who are free to travel.
Yeah. So Pooja, any specific reason why you're not willing? Is it the fear of missing out on classes, or is it any other specific reason?
No, generally, I don't really want to travel outstation audits. Okay. Because the work conditions might not be, because you learn the same thing in Bombay as well. So,
So you are based out of Mumbai?
Yes.
Yeah, so what happens is, see, this is very specific to the client that your future firm might have. And even if it involves outstation audit, from my personal experience, the entire audit is not conducted over there. You just have to go there for a couple of weeks, 1 or 2 weeks, and then you'll be back. So, and the arrangements and everything is also decent and good. So if you have any other reservation regarding going outstation audit, only then you categorically mention that you don't want to go for outstation audit. Otherwise, I think even if you are made to go, it should not be an issue. So that's my suggestion.
All right. And is this like dependent on like big fours or mid-sized firms?
Yeah, or it's firm to it's client specific. So
okay.
Also, Pooja, I would suggest, see, audit is such a profession, like sooner or later, or like any point of time in your life, you will be, you are supposed to travel, you know, maybe for some kind of audit or stock count or anything. So it's very likely in a profession like audit that you travel. So if you have like strict rules or you're very stringent about traveling, then maybe you can choose to go for taxation. Because even for articleship purpose, like, not all around the year, but like at least for a week or 2 weeks, or you know, in a couple of months or every quarter, you might have to travel. Even if you are given this liberty not to travel in any particular firm, but if you go to any other firm in the same profession, it might be a challenge for you.
Also, Pooja, my personal experience has been that it's fun going for outstation audit. So one of my best memories have been when I've gone for an outstation audit and met new people, gone to new places. It's a totally different experience. So I would say you reconsider this reservation and think over it.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Next question, please.
Sir, should I ask one?
Yeah, Amit, please.
Sir, I have a question that in the interview, lastly, they asked that if you have any question to ask to us, so what should we ask them?
Okay, so maybe you can have, if you really have any question to ask, like you will research about the organization, if there is anything you want to ask, You can ask, okay, if you have any query, feel free to ask, but make sure that you don't ask questions around holidays, perks, weekends off. Avoid such kind of question. And it's advisable if you can have a couple of questions, intelligent questions prepared. You know, maybe ask for your career path ahead. If you, you know, do your article here, what might be your career path ahead? What are the levels? Have questions like that. Any other mentor who would like to add to the question?
I would like to add. You can go ahead. So, yeah.
Please, Amay, go ahead. I'll take it after.
Okay, all right. Also, it's most important to ask the relevant question. Like, let's say if you are in a technical round interview and asking a question relevant to, let's say, what will be the procedure, the procedure or HR related question. Probably the technical interview might not be aware of the specific that particular type of question. So ask relevant questions to the relevant type of interviewer. So that's one of the take which I would like to give. Yeah, over to you, Raj.
Yeah, so to add to Amaya's point, so like you can ask, you should always ask relevant questions to the relevant persons. And it's not like it ke you are asking, it should not be that you are asking for the sake of asking. Only if you have a genuine question, go ahead and pose it. So you can mention, okay, I wish to work on banking clients. So will I be given an opportunity to work on? I wish to work on a tax audit assignment. I wish to work on, suppose specifically, I wish to learn about Indus. So I want to work in that area. So you can definitely ask such sort of questions. And they will answer your queries whether they would be able to accommodate or not. And at the HR round, so like I've seen my colleagues asking a question like, we had gone to one of the big fours and they had the meeting rooms named after rivers. So one of my friends, just out of curiosity, asked the question to an HR guy, okay, why is this? Is there any specific reason? Or why do you have a green dot after the name Deloitte? No, such it was natural. It was not, okay, I'm going to ask this question. I'm going to appear for the interview only to ask such question. But it was just out of curiosity. And that sometimes, because just to have a two-way conversation, sometimes you need to pose some questions so that interviewer is also like, he'll also feel that he's also involved. It should not be a one-way process. Okay, you are only answering.
Okay. Rightly said. Also, I just remembered while I was going for a technical round, it was taken for a manager level person. So, and every round and most of the round people, they ask this question out of courtesy. So as Raj said, it don't be under compulsion that, okay, I need to ask, otherwise I might not look very smart. There's nothing like that. You can simply say, okay, no, I don't have any question. Thank you. And you can conclude. And if I would like to say tell you about the question which I asked. So that was a manager level person into organization for so many years. So I asked him, you have been in this position and spent so many years with the firm. And as I'm just beginning my career in this field and I'll be going for an articleship, what would be you suggest me? Something like that. You can even take any kind of guidance from them. Like if you go for a partner round, technical round, so you get an opportunity to interact with a senior level, people. So you can ask genuine question and take an opportunity to have a word with them, have their guidance, which normally you don't get even when you write so many messages on LinkedIn. So have this opportunity, keep this in mind. You can take some guidance from them.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So my question is that is doing articleship from Big Four a prerequisite for pursuing a job abroad? Like after becoming a chartered accountant, if one wants to pursue a job abroad, so do they prefer candidates who have done articleship from Big Four or a mid-sized firm would be fine?
Ideally, to answer this question, Big Fours, people who have done articleship from Big Fours do tend to have an added advantage only if the firm is looking. So if the firm where you want to apply is looking, has specifically mentioned, okay, articles from a Big Four background need to apply. So if only if recruiter is looking for such thing, then maybe because they've already in their heads, in their mind, the person must have a well corporate experience and they don't want to spend too much time in grooming you or something like that. But usually it doesn't matter. And second is if you have a rank, then obviously whether you are from a Big Four or not a Big Four, that goes for a secondary thing, because rankers do tend to have an added advantage at the start of their career.
Yeah, okay.
To add upon, like if you are planning to go abroad, so is it on the basis of your CA as a degree, or you would pursue some additional degree as well, like let's say a master's or let's say an MBA at a later stage?
Well, I have just given foundation in November, but I'm planning to do CFA or CPA, CMA US along with CA.
Okay, then that would do definitely come into more along a better picture for getting a job abroad rather as well.
Because after this presentation, so thank you so much. I actually, I'm able to decide that after inter that I might go to a mid-sized firm, because mid-sized firm gives you the exposure to all the fields, and it comes down to becoming a good chartered accountant. So you get the exposure to all the fields. So, but if I have some this in mind that if I want to go abroad, so if is a Big Four would be preferable or not? So yeah. But as you said that if I will pursue other courses, then Big Four is not a prerequisite, right?
So if you pursue other courses, because since they are globally recognized, let's say you are doing a CPA, CPA Canada, and you are planning to go to Canada. So that course would become in more priority for any job application rather than the Indian CA course, which would be for that. To be an added advantage, let's say if you do in a mid-sized firm, and if you have a relevant managerial experience regarding, let's say, handle certain audits, you can state up that in your statement of purpose, which is there, or else any of the recommendation letters, if you can get it through, that would also be an added advantage to it. So it's totally upon you how you'd like to shape your the application for any of the foreign admits or any foreign job profiles.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay. Before we move on to the next question, quick request, can we have a group photo? I know we are virtual, but these are very important memories. So requesting you to turn on your video just for a minute. So I'll just quickly take the photo and then we can go to the next question. Just a minute. Okay, Rupal and HP's videos are off, no problem. Just a second, I'll cover it up. All right, we can, thank you. So we can continue, yeah.
Okay, so I guess that answers your question, right?
Yes,
okay,
thank you.
Okay, so next one is, I guess, Supriya is there. She has raised her hand.
Yes, I had this question. If one is looking out for advisory and one has to choose whether to do internal audit or statutory audit, what would you suggest?
You said somebody is looking for advisory.
Yeah, somewhat advisory, or maybe something like, mergers and acquisitions. So if you're given only two choices, like statutory audit and internal audit, because that's the only option, right, in the Big Fours right now. So what would you suggest on that?
Supriya, maybe I'll suggest you to not go for Big Four and go for firms like BDO, who have this option of giving you exposure in advisory at articleship level. Okay, so that will be more beneficial and helpful for you. If you have, if you're sure you want to get into advisory, even though you are pursuing your articleship from BDO, which is a really good firm, and it hardly makes any difference, because you're getting relevant experience, and going from articleship advisory experience to getting a job in advisory later on will be much more easier. While if you are coming from a statutory audit or internal audit background to advisory, there will be a competition for you. And not all Big Four articles coming from statutory audit get to go in advisory, because there's still a competition. So advisory is like that cream profile which everybody wants to be in. So it's better if you go for other firms like BDO where you get exposure to advisory, and the firm is also really good and renowned.
Yes, thank you. But then what if I'm planning to do industrial training in some of the IB banks, IB, and so like if I do my articleship in Big Fours, that would really try to bring out greater possibility to get into IBs, right? But if I tried, BDO is not that good as compared to Big Fours, but then it's okay. But would that reduce any sort of chances?
No. I think BDO, like it's known for its taxation and its advisory. Okay, so it's just that it's not in Big Four, but yeah, after Big Four, it is BDO. So don't think that PwC will have or any other Big Four will have a, you know, heavier weightage and BDO will not add to it. So I just to tell you that BDO is equally good firm. It's just it is not a part of Big Four. And coming to statutory audit or internal audit, then I think, I don't know, but you can go for statutory audit.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah,
thank you.
You're nice for that.
Also, you would like having a relevant experience in specifically, let's say, M&A or transaction advisory, and the IB, the investment banks or any of these firms do prefer a relevant experience as well. So you can definitely consider that as one of the options so that they would have an edge, like you would have this relevant experience. So you can consider that as well.
Yeah, and in statutory audit, go for financial institutions so that you have banking experience, NBFC experience, which will help you. And I suppose statutory audit gives you wider exposure. You know, you go to client's place, you spend more time, you work on financials. So that gives you really good exposure.
Just to add here, Supriya, it is also not necessary that if you've not done your articleship from Big Four, you would not get into advisory, because I myself have done articleship from a mid-sized firm, and without any reference, I've gotten to mergers and acquisitions EY. So it's possible that you have done your articleship from some mid-sized firm, but if your experience is good enough, then you can get into Big Four advisory.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
And to add one more point, statutory audit is more relevant experience, because for going into transaction advisory, they would prefer stat audit experience than internal audit.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so next question, I think Akshaya has raised.
Yeah, so I like, as like when we are looking for articleship opportunities, we tend to apply for both like Big Fours and also mid-sized firms as a plan B, right? But I like mid-sized firms, they tend to have a quicker screening process than Big Four. So is it like wise? So what if I get selected in a medium-sized firm and like they want me to join the firm as soon as possible, but is it like wise to reject that offer and wait for Big Fours to respond back? And
Akshaya, just keep one thing in mind, that even the articleship firms need you as much as you need them. So it is quite possible that you can just tell them that you are waiting for some, waiting for an answer from some other firm. Or if you're not willing to disclose that, you can always take time from them, maybe a couple of days, and you can even drag a bit for a more couple of days, and you can make them wait. And that should not be a problem with the HRs.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the second option, which Hetvi said, you should not try to go that way. So you can always tell them, okay, I need a couple of days to like think over it. I'm still evaluating it, evaluating my choice, and I'll let you know.
Okay.
So just be polite with them, and I'm sure if they have spent time and they have spent one or two rounds of interview with you, and they are waiting for you, they will won't mind waiting for two or three more days if you are surely expecting a call from a Big Four within such time period.
Okay, thank you.
But most importantly, respond to them. Tell them you want 2-3 days.
Yes.
It's not like you're not picking them their calls or something like that.
Thank you.
Next is, I think we have Jairaj, who has raised his hand. Jairaj, if you would.
Yeah, sure. This question is out of actually curiosity. I just wanted to know experiences of y'all from Big Four. Can you please share it? Means if you Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Jared, you're audible.
Yeah.
So, who would like to take this up?
Prithi, I would like you to take this up.
Yeah, I think the senior most should take.
So, I think, Jairaj, each one of us, we are from same firm, like 2-3 of us, and even same team, few of us, but each one of us have different experience, completely different set of experiences and challenges and learnings. Okay. And even though a Big Four has more than 100 articles, each one of them will have their own unique experiences. So first of all, you should not judge a Big Four's experience based on somebody else's experience. It might happen that you go and you have an entirely different experience, because even though you're a part of a bigger organization, it is ultimately your team and manager, and the clients you work on that will shape your experience and exposure in Big Four. So just for your curiosity, if you want to know, then yes, it was a roller coaster ride. Okay, and it was really amazing. It really helped me groom as a person. And when I left the firm a year ago, my caption, the photo was like, a naive teenager walked in and a confident professional walked out. So that's what you can experience, expect from a Big Four. You get to speak to big clients. It gives you a lot of confidence. Your personality gets groomed. And of course, you are a part of the best crowd of the country. No matter what, which Big Four you are in. There are articles from all around the country, from south, from north, from east and west. So based on my experience, I was from, I'm from Indore, so a smaller city. I went to Mumbai and I got to connect with all these people. And they're all very unique. The set of, that was a kind of people and a set of people I had never seen in my life, like coming from a smaller city. So it was a great experience for me. And, given a choice again, I'll go through it 100 times again.
Just want to ask also, I just heard that there are many much politics in corporates and Big Fours. So I can just know about it.
Politics is everywhere. Even if you are in a joint family, big family, there will be politics. So, jahan log honge, wahan thoda bahut politics hoga hi. But if you are good at your work, then you don't need to be, you don't need to care about it. If your work speaks for yourself, then nobody can harm you or nobody can do anything. You just need to be good at work, keep your heads down, work on your stuff, and then, relax.
Not relevant for articleship, Jairaj.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, next question, anyone? Anyone else?
I think we have done a great job, and now people, they're done with their questions.
Everything. All right. So,
hey, Prithvi, can we just have a photo once more? I wasn't in it, actually.
Arre, Jairaj, apan
the family. That's so sweet.
चलो वीडियो ऑन कर दो एक सेकंड जयराज आप कर लो वीडियो ऑन ले लेता हूँ फटाफट डन
मैम कैन यू जस्ट टेल अस हाउ शुड वी प्रोसीड आफ्टर दिस रिजल्ट कम्स आउट
सॉरी
कैन यू जस्ट टेल अस हाउ शुड वी प्रोसीड आफ्टर दिस रिजल्ट कम्स आउट
Proceed after
if
the.
If you want to join Big Four.
Okay, so I think you asked this question in chat box, and I said, "Kiar, why are you waiting for result? You can even apply now. If you don't clear, then it's fine. You don't go for an interview, but you can apply at least for now. Let me tell you my case. My result were out on 31st of July. 2 days before that, 29th of July, I had interview call in my mailbox. Kyunki come for an interview. So even if you have, you can apply, then go apply. Even if you've not, then even after result, just go and apply. If you're a part of Vision CA group.
I have sent CVs to a few people, but I have not got any response from anywhere. And that's why I'm a bit discouraged.
Okay, so if your CV has got uploaded on the portal, then there is an auto-generated email which you get, and there comes a form link through which you have to fill this detailed form. Prithvi, I guess it's the same even now.
Yeah, same process.
So maybe your CV is not uploaded. Maybe you can check with those who you have forwarded your resume to. You can do a follow-up. You can ask them, you know, can you please upload my CV?
Arko, you can share it with us. We'll try to get it across.
Surely, sir, I will do.
Yeah, cool.
So we have one more question over the chat box. Is it advisable to do CMA and CS together with CA, or only concentrating in one will be advisable? So I guess Raj can throw a light on this.
Raj is the most ideal person to answer.
So like doing a course along with CA, so like better to like test. So like I've done CS along with CA, and so like earlier I was interested in law, so I thought of pursuing company secretary as well. And it always, based on my experience, it always adds to your knowledge. So whether be it on the job or off the job, when you are in front, like sitting in a with in your team, and when the team is posing a question, and even the including the partner, and you get to answer it, then you feel that confidence within you. Okay, because I could respond it based on my knowledge. And also, so other courses, like if you are interested in finance, so you can go for CFA, because CFA, I also understand there are levels in it, and you can easily clear first and second level, along with your CA if you manage your studies. But always remember that your ultimate goal is to become a chartered accountant first, so it should not be impacted because of that. You have to take out some time for your CA course as well, so make it a priority. And the other things, you have to manage it. So if you are studying for CA for 2-3 hours, and you can obviously spare some 1 or 2 hours for the other courses, but during those study leaves, I would advise stay diligent and focus only on CA first. If once you are through CA at the age of 22, you have still have a lot of years to pursue other courses, and by that time you will get more clarity on which field I am interested in, which field I want to do a specialization, and that would be more beneficial, rather than jumping on everything. Like, it should not happen that you have opened up 5 courses for you and now you're struggling to finish off even one. Take it at a step-by-step approach. 1 or 2 courses, along with CE, you can obviously manage 1 or 2 courses, but would not advise to jump into everything and just you want to pursue this course as well, that course as well. Decide your interest, and if that field interests you, obviously go for it.
I hope that answers your question. Okay. So we'll probably move on to the next question, which is posted in the chat box. How to deal with the group discussion when one has less knowledge on that topic?
Okay. Can you please pardon the question?
How to deal with group discussion when one has the less knowledge on that topic?
Okay. So most importantly, there are very few firms which will, which have this group discussion round. So even if you have, if you know you're going for a group discussion, you need to be updated about what is going on right now, like a budget. Okay, so budget is something you would like to keep yourself updated with, because there's a likelihood on having a discussion on that topic. So keep yourself updated. Okay, that's the best way you can avoid being in a situation when you don't have any clue about the topic which you are being asked to. Even if it is not so, then you can add to the group discussion with whatever knowledge you have. Okay, so group discussion, they analyze both your knowledge and also your behavior, like how you're behaving in a group discussion, how you're participating in group discussion. If there is anything you can add from your end, then add. But it shouldn't be like you are saying for the sake of saying, and somebody else who's trying to make a relevant point, you are not letting the other person speak. Okay, maybe just try to get a few insight knowledge from others' discussion and try to be a part of it. But to avoid this situation, I'll definitely recommend, if you're going for a group discussion, keep yourself updated with current affairs, latest news. It's a must. Otherwise, you don't stand a chance if you are not able to speak well on the topic.
So any other questions, or are we good to go? And even after the session ends, and any of your questions which you have in your mind, you can reach out to us on the groups. You know, we reply as soon as possible. We try our best. So that should not be an issue. So guys, how was the webinar? I think it was amazing. What about you guys? How was it? You guys liked it?
Yes, sir. It was very informative.
It was very informative. Yeah, it was very helpful.
Glad to have the review comments. Thank you for having the joining the session, and I would also like to thank the panelists and the other mentors. So Amaya, Ayushi, Hetvi, Sanjay, Upamanyu, Prithvi, you all have done a great job. I think the session was quite informative. In fact, I had some key takeaways. Thanks. So thanks for that. And we'll definitely have such sessions, more informative sessions going ahead. And we wish you all the best for tomorrow's result. We believe that you will clear and pass out with flying colors tomorrow. So
tomorrow, all of you have to join Vision CA final group.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
Also, what else do I have to say? So, yeah, just to add one more thing. So, Ayushi Garg is a professional trainer. She takes, she is into training now, and she conducts her own student related courses and everything. And she's a mentor also. So, you can reach out to her. So, if you want to know more, and I would like to thank our sponsor, Shreyansh Academy, for arranging the Zoom link for us so that we were able to provide this session for free for everyone. And our motto is to be not for profit only, and we'll be relying on other good organizations that are helping in our cause. And also, most importantly, we depend on you guys to spread the word regarding Vision CA and get as many students as possible, so we can help. So we have more than 60 CAs right now as mentors. So we have a good capacity to deal with the students. So you get as many friends of yours as possible, because we totally rely on you and your word of mouth. That's how it started, and that's how it's still going on. So many thanks to each and every one of you for coming. Special thanks to all the mentors, for everyone who thanks Raj for being such an amazing coordinator and host. Hoping to see you guys again as CA finalists in the next webinar, and hope to see you soon. All the best, everyone. Thank you.
Okay. Goodbye. Bye, folks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.